Just before the turn of the century, my wife and my kids and me settled along Duck Creek. There wasn't much there in terms of business in those days, mind you, but it sure was beautiful. We farmed cotton, most everyone did, and it was plentiful and good. Right over there, me and my neighbors built the kids a school. We thought we were something in those days, full of vim, vigor, and determination. But boy, we sure did have fun. Right, Ma?
Today's Garland, a 60-square-mile city, began as a dot on the west bank of Duck Creek. In 1874, a man named Moles built a small store on the west bank of Duck Creek, and there men and women began buying their wares and supplies. 2 years later, the store added a grist mill, and industrialization in Texas began. When the Santa Fe and the MKT railroads came this way in the 1880s, they both missed Duck Creek by a country mile.
We were mad. Our pride was hurt. We needed that railroad to grow. But the railroad didn't need us.
In 1886, the Santa Fe Railroad bought half the old William Tinsley farm and subdivided it into a town they named Embry, in honor of a local pioneer physician, Dr. K.H. Embry. This was later to become South Garland. 8 months later, the MKT Railroad built its depot in what is now North Garland. They called it New Duck Creek. For the folks who lived in Old Duck Creek, this caused a conflict.
There were three towns then. We knew that we had to live near a railroad to prosper. So we upped and moved on to New Duck Creek. But our neighbors down the road moved to Embry. It was confusing. It caused a lot of hard feelings. See, no New Duck Creek lad would ever go a-courting an Embry lass. And it was only in the dead of night that an Embry lad would be found in New Duck Creek. And that was just play a prank. Like the time we let out all the pigs and chickens off. Oh, boy. We sure did have something right, Mom.
But the businessmen of the two towns played more serious games. They spent their time competing for trade. Competition was good for growth, and both towns grew. Embry had a thriving newspaper, so Duck Creek decided it too needed a newspaper. In 1887, newspaperman John H. Cullum received this letter.
Dear John, can't you come over to Duck Creek and give us a local newspaper that'll keep its nose clean and tell the truth? Come up and let's talk the matter over. Your friend, T.F. Nash.
When John Cullum came to Duck Creek, he found a small town with several stores, a meat market, a barber shop, and a blacksmith shop. Not very inviting for a successful newspaperman. But after talking with farmers in the outlying area, Cullum learned that their sympathies and support lay with New Duck Creek, mainly because of their allegiance to its name. They would ride right through Embry and do business in New Duck Creek. So John Cullum decided,
well, sink or swim, I was going to cast my lot with that little struggling town and help build and develop it.
And with town support, he did. A lively newspaper feud developed between Embry's Enterprise and the Duck Creek's News. The issue of a post office divided the towns even more. Duck Creekers had to collect their mail in Embry, and to the embarrassment of all Duck Creekers, their beloved newspaper had to be mailed from their rival town. On a trip to Washington, Texas Congressman Joe Abbott resolved the disputes between the two towns diplomatically. He successfully sponsored a bill in Congress that joined Duck Creek and Embry in a common post office. He might be labeled one of the most successful diplomats of his time. In 1887, the towns put aside their grudges, shook hands, and joined forces under one name, Garland, in honor of A.H. Garland, Attorney General during the first Grover Cleveland administration. In 1891, Garland was incorporated. Garlanders elected M.D. Williams their first mayor. Thanksgiving Day, 1889. Fire swept through Garland. The flames blazed out of control. By the time it was over, 28 businesses were destroyed. No fire could extinguish Garland's pride and determination. The ashes were still smoldering when Garland's businessmen and city fathers embarked on their first city planning efforts. This time, businesses were rebuilt in brick around a newly purchased plot of land, a city square that is today the center of downtown Garland. The 20th century brought promises, changes, and the unexpected. Garland was just a small rural town then. In the back room of her local drugstore, W.B. Woman and John T. Jones were thinking anything but small. In 1905, the U.S. Treasury Department granted them a charter to open what was then called National Bank of Garland. Far from fancy, no chairs for customers, just a counter and a steel safe for the money. But it was here to stay. The first employee, A.R. Davis, who later became the chairman of the board, wrote,
"In the beginning, as the only employee, my duties as cashier also included sweeping out. In fact, I was a teller, bookkeeper, in charge of all the valuables and money kept in the iron safe, since I was the only one who knew the combination."
The history of Garland and the history of the First National Bank throughout the 20th century are inseparable. A financial institution is vital to the growth of the community it serves. The First National was a strong force supporting city-owned utilities. In 1922, Garland built a waterworks and a sewer system, financed by a bond issue. The city council bargained for outside electric power, but found it too costly. Realizing they could operate their own cheaper, the city built a power plant. From a rural community where not even a railroad wanted to go, Garland mushroomed from a population of 1,500 in 1920 to more than 100,000 today. The First National Bank was once again part of this progress, financing the city's expanding businesses, industries, and institutions, and providing loans to the people who made Garland their home. Today, Garlanders enjoy good schools and libraries, cultural and recreational activities, excellent hospital and municipal services, magnificent parks, and much more. We at First National Bank in Garland are proud to be a part of Garland's past, present, and future.